गुरुर्ब्रह्मा गुरुर्विष्णुः गुरुर्देवो महेश्वरः गुरुस्साक्षात् परं ब्रह्म तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः सच्चिदानन्दरूपाय विश्वोत्पत्यादिहेतवे तापत्रय विनाशाय श्रीकृष्णाय वयं नमः श्रीकृष्णाय वयं नमः ॐ योऽन्तः प्रविश्य मम वाचमिमा प्रसुप्तां सञ्जीवयत्यखिलशक्तिधरस्वधाम्नाम् अन्याश्च हस्तचरण श्रवणत्वगादी प्राणो भगवते पुरुषाय तुभ्यम् प्राणान् नमो भगवते पुरुषाय तुभ्यम् प्राणान् नमो भगवते पुरुषाय तुभ्यम् वी आर् इन् भागवतम् केण्टो 11 चाप्टर् 10 And in last few chapters, we saw the 24 gurus of Dattatreya Maharaj, and that was given through the story of King Yadu asking question to the young Brahmana who was sitting under the tree, who was none other than Lord Dattatreya. And having told towards the end, what was it told? That where are we? It said in the last verse of the 9th chapter, Na hyekasmad guror jnanam susthiram syat supushkalam brahmai tad dvitiyam vai giyate bahudharshibihi. Stable and comprehensive knowledge cannot be had from one teacher alone. You have to be open to that one teacher within who is expressing as many teachers outside. And that teacher is not necessarily a human being. We saw through the Dattatreya's story. It was a pigeon, it was a snake, it was a python, it was a pingala, it was a spider, it was the wasp, and so on. So many different, 24 gurus. And 24 gurus doesn't mean that you stop there. Every moment we are getting exposed to something in this creation. Do we have that eye which can convert that experience that you're having into coming back to yourself to recognize the guru principle functioning at that very moment? Are you learning from something? So right now, what is your interaction? If your attention is on me, the interaction is you're looking at me. If your attention is on the words, then you are listening to the words. If your attention is on your posture, then your attention is on the body. It's not on me. You thinking that it is on me, but it is not. If that moment suddenly the phone goes ping and your attention goes to the message that has come, then your attention is not on the body, not on the talk, not on the person who's speaking, but it is on the phone. So, every moment we are getting exposed to something or the other. Life is coming to us. Are we learning? Or are we living at default level? And Dattatreya Maharaj teaches us that learn from everything. The ability to learn from every passing experience. Then alone you are abiding in the Guru Tattva. It's not you are not surrendered to Guru Maharaj. You are abiding in Guru Tattva. And that Guru Tattva is the Sadguru within you, the essence within you, the Atma within you. And that Sadguru, just like in the dream, you can produce n number of gurus who come and guide you in the dream. Similarly, in this waking dream, the self alone has manifested as these gurus who are coming and guiding you. So let's not just stop at one teacher or one person or one text or one. No, it's there is it's a buffet. Enjoy. It's your creation, not as an individual. It's the Atmic creation. It's the Ishwara's creation. So in this way, he said, stable and comprehensive knowledge cannot be acquired from one preceptor. And therefore, this Brahma, one without a second, has been variously sung by the Rishis. So, various Upanishads. It is not always between, yes, it is a student or a teacher. It is sometimes a wife and a husband. Sometimes it is a dialogue. But it's always not a dialogue between the same student and the same teacher. It is different sets of students and teachers, isn't it? Here, who was the student? King Yadu. Who was the teacher? Dattatreya Maharaj. And he doesn't say, it is my experience. He says that, there's no doubt. But he is saying, this is what I learned from the nature. Somewhere else, it is told, this is what my teacher taught me. Another place, it says, the story of, where we were reading? In Vivek Chudamani. And there, it says, forgetting the self, itself is death. This statement came. Forgetting the self itself is death. So, the moment you forget the self, what happens? Duality appears. Duality is death. Now, who said this? Sanat Kumaras told that. Who were Sanat Kumaras? Brahma's mind-born children. So, Sanat Kumar said that. So, he didn't, Shankaracharya is not saying, I am saying that. He says, this was seconded by Sanat Kumaras. So, that is another angle. So, last time we concluded with this thought that you are sitting in this room, everyone has a different angle of this room, isn't it? And can you come to a position where you are able to appreciate every person's angle of vision? My way or the highway, not that way. So how I'm looking, in my east is the kitchen, and you say no. In my south, in my west is the kitchen. Where is east? Wherever you face is the east, not where the sun rises. Where you face is the east. So you say, no, kitchen is in the west, I say kitchen is the east. Argument started. But then, if you have a vision which sees, I understand they are facing this way, then you will accept, yes, you are right. But that does not mean I am wrong. Both are right. Okay. So this way, one must be able to appreciate the presence of reality in and through everything. To come to that, only one way, maybe for some person, it may work. But we love variety by nature as an individual. So, learn, grasp, not because I learned from him and then I learned everything from him, now I'll go to him. No, I've learned everything from him. He has got nothing to teach me, so I go to him. No, not like that is wrong. I must be available to him 100%. I must be available to him 100%, meaning my mind, but my attention must be on the self within. These are just prompters. When we are chanting, Vedic chanting, or when your children are learning 2 1s are 2 2s are 4, 2 3s are, or now I'm Sanskrit, I'm teaching, some kids are there, about 10 kids are there. So, I have to say, ka, kha, ga, gha, or in your class, aham, avam, vayam, I ask, they all keep quiet. Who's going to start? Then they will follow. Why? They are not confident. And then the moment Saket says, Pathami, everyone suddenly clicks in and everyone's voice comes out. Why? Because they didn't want to be the first one. What if I'm wrong? Maybe wrong. Say confidently. See? So that time the prompt was Saket. Sometimes it is me. But the moment the first word is prompted, you know what the type of ending is, and immediately the rest 8 of them flow because they have piloted them very well now. The moment I say aham, automatically they say aham, avam, vayam, tvam, yuvam, yuyam, sahata, tote, sateta. But after 3, 4, 5, 6 months of gap, suddenly they come, okay, start, tell the pronouns, lost. See, prompt. So everyone who is coming in our, like in Dattatreya's life, every person who is coming in our life, there is something to learn. It cannot be that any person who is coming has got nothing to teach you. There is always something to learn. Something to learn that you can, so that you can come back to the essential nature. Or at the worldly level, something that you want to imbibe, those qualities, or something that you don't want to be like that person. So that is also learning, that I don't want to be like that. That is also learning. But not because you don't like that person. It is because that is not conducive for me on my journey to the self. So, having told all that, once again, the teacher is reiterating that the emptiness of earthly and otherworldly enjoyments exposed, meaning whatever is on this earth and whatever is in the other heavens, Om Bhur Bhuva Swa Tapa Jana Maha Satyam, all these 7 lokas, and there are other lokas below also, but these 7 lokas, we call them as heaven, isn't it? So how these heavens of different at different levels are also nothing but empty. Don't seek them. Only seek the truth. Only seek merging into the divine. Don't seek going to want, I will go to heaven. Why? Because I'll get whatever I want. Then you are here also individuality, there also individuality. So here the topic begins. Lord Shri Krishna is telling this learning to Uddhavji Maharaj. And this is happening at the time when Shri Krishna is about to conclude his avatar. And here he says, Shri Bhagavan Uvacha Mayoditeshva Vahitaha Swadharmeshu Madashrayaha Varnashrama Kulacharam Akamatma Samacharet Anvikshetha Vishuddhatma Dehinam Vishayatmanam Guneshu Tattva Dhyanena Sarvarambha Paryayam Suptasya Vishayaloko Dhyayato Vamanorathaha Nanatmakaltvat Vifalaha Tatha Again Nanatmakatvat Vifalaha Tatha bhedatma dhir gunaihi nivrutam karma seveta pravruttam mat parastyajet jignyasayam sampravrutto nadriyeta kamachodanam yamanamikshanam sveveta niyamanamat parakvachita madabhignyam gurum shantam upasita madatmakam amanyamatsaro daksho nirmamo drda sauhrudaha asatvarortha jigyasuhu anasuyuramo ramoghavak jayapatya gruhakshetraha swajanadravinyadishu udasina samam pashyan sarveshwartha manaha. Okay, till 7. So here he says, first verse is mayoditeshva vahitaha swadharmeshu madashrayaha varnashrama kulacharam akamatma samacharet. He says, attentive to the righteous duties taught by me and depending upon me and forsaking all desires, man should follow the conduct prescribed by his caste, order and family. What is the It is Swadharmeshu Madashraya. See, we talk about हमारा धर्म ये नहीं है कि हम अपनी फैमिली की we have to take care of our family. Is it not our duty to take care of our children? Is it not our duty to take care of our parents? Is it not duty to go and work and toil so that I can take care of? We talk about duty towards the family, isn't it? So much. Isn't it my duty to buy a house so that my family can call it a home? Right? And majority, 99% of the people are lost in this only. And any time you bring the topic of spirituality, the first top point, the topic they bring is my duty. But don't you ever think even for a moment that if you have duty towards your parents, your children, your wife, your husband, etc., don't you have duty towards the one who created you, the God? Is there not a little bit feeling coming in your heart that I have some duty towards Him also? See? When are you going to do that duty towards God, who has given this creation to you, who has given this body to you, who has given the parents to you, who has given the breath to you, the heartbeat to you, the hunger to you, after retirement? Then it's too late because you are already sick and disease has taken over. Then you will not, then your duty will be to remove the disease, not do the duty of remembering the God. It's too late then. See? And this is the trap that man falls into. Man, woman, both, human being falls into. Because he doesn't want to, either he is lazy to think about God because he has been told or he knows that he is always there. So let me focus on my family. But they forget that God says that you are in my image. That you forget. So is there anything in you which is expressing like the God? You can't even smile like God for no reason. You can't do an act without a purpose behind it, without a gain behind it. Think. So here it is told. No, sayoditeshva vahitaha swadharmeshu madashraya. Take ashray. Ashray means refuge. Take refuge in your swadharma. What is your swadharma? Different definition. Swadharma. Dharma is duty, righteousness. Swa is self-righteousness. What is your, and the lower meaning is the what is your duty? So what is your duty? Is your duty towards your family? Is your duty towards your community? Is your duty towards the Victoria? Is your duty towards Australia? Is your duty towards India and Australia? Is your duty towards the whole universe? All Earth? Is your duty towards the whole universe? Or is your duty towards the God who created this universe? Why you want to just stay a teeny meeny nobody? Or not teeny meeny nobody, teeny meeny somebody in this vast creation? And what are you getting out of all the duties that you are doing in life? What are you getting? Are you getting peace of mind? I'm not ask. Don't answer. I'll come to know. Answer inside only. Because then that will become example somewhere else. Without names. So all the duties, all the actions that you have performed in the name of duty towards your family, have they given you peace of mind? Have they given you happiness till today? They have given moments of happiness. They have given you moments of joy. But your overriding thinking is that I must do my duty. I must do my duty towards the community. But has it given you lasting happiness? That तुम मस्त हो रहा है जो हो रहा है. इट इफ इट हैज नॉट हैपन देन समवेयर यू आर गोइंग रॉन्ग इन योर ड्यूटी. समवेयर यू आर गोइंग रॉन्ग इन योर ड्यूटी. सो दैट मस्ती दैट कॉज फ्री ब्लिस कॉज फ्री जॉय दैट इज मस्ती फॉर नो रीजन. दैट विल ओनली कम व्हेन वी कम टू रियलाइज अबाउट आवर ड्यूटी टुवर्ड्स द लॉर्ड. सो विद द कमिटमेंट दैट यू आर टेकिंग डूइंग द ड्यूटी टुवर्ड्स योर फैमिली विद दैट इवन मोर कमिटमेंट. वाई डू यू डू इट? बिकॉज यू लव देम, इजंट इट? यू लव योर फैमिली, दैट्स वाई यू डू द ड्यूटी. अदरवाइज यू विल नॉट डू इट. वेन यू फॉल इन लव दैट हे ऑल दिस वॉज नॉट पॉसिबल इफ ही वॉज नॉट देयर. एंड द मोर यू फॉल इन लव विद हिम द मोर यू स्टार्ट डूइंग योर ड्यूटी टूवर्ड्स हिम. एंड हाउ डू यू डू ड्यूटी ड्यूटी टूवर्ड्स हिम? ही डजेंट से दैट यू हैव टू ओनली टेक माई फोटोग्राफ पुट इट इन फ्रंट एंड देन फॉरगेट योर फैमिली एंड देन अरे राम हरे राम 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 हरे 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 कृष्ण 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 हरे हरे. ही इज नॉट सेइंग दैट. ही इज सेइंग वॉट एवर ड्यूटी यू आर डूइंग इन लाइफ यू डू इट फॉर माई सेक. लॉर्ड इज सेइंग. एंड हियर आवर पोजिशन इज दैट वुमन वॉन्ट टू वेयर पैंट्स, मैन वॉन्ट टू वेयर स्कर्ट्स, इक्वालिटी. Why? Why he has got this job and he is getting this salary? Why am I not getting doing this? I am doing the same job and why am I not getting the same salary? Comparison, competition. Why is this going on? And for this, there is no answer because the world has always been like this. So here it is told, according to your varnashram. What is your varnashram? Normally, varnashram is Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra. Is that by birth?
No.
Then how is it? Based on what? Two things? Action and knowledge. Karma and jnana. Find out. When you are focused on yourself, you know yourself. You have data from childhood till now. You know what is your propensity. What inspires you, what attracts you, what you are interested in. Some people are interested in studies of scriptures. Was I interested in studies of scriptures from the time I was born? No. Every child is born a Shudra. Totally dependent, no knowledge. Can't do any activity. Only crying activity. Shudra. Shudra is he who only always complains and cries. Then as you grow up, you become Vaishya. This is mine, I will not give my toys to someone else to play, mine, 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 mine. Look at some children, the whole box, if you go and touch their box, you know, our Padmini's son, when he was young, 3-4 years old, and 4-5 years old, and they had some video on Krishna Leela, Vishnu Puran, and I had only given them to see it, the complete series. And I came and I said, Arre, for so many months I have not seen, I want to see it, I'll take mine. And no, it is mine. And that's 5 year old, after the class, I enjoy making them cry. And he cried at the top of his voice, I will not give this, I will not give this, this is mine, I will not give it. You think it bothers me? I was enjoying his crying. Similarly, when we cry, this is my wife, this is my children, this is my house, this is my car, he laughs up there. He's laughing. This silly fellow. For him, it is a game. You have to raise yourself to that level. So Vaishya Vritti is where everything is about greed. It's me, me, me. Some people you will see around yourself or within yourself, you have grown, you become managers of a trust, or you become community leaders. This is, you become prime ministers, you become generals. Huh? You are able to get a team together to get some certain jobs done. Someone says, nobody will tell me, Swamiji, can you organize some people to clean the Shiva Vishnu temple? I said, forget, take a hike, man. I don't have the time for that. That vritti is not there in me. But once upon a time, when I was in the ashram, all such jobs used to come to me only. Swamiji used to say, every Shivratri, before 10 days before Shivratri, I used to, 2 years in a row it happened, I was given the job. Please organize, we have to, the temple must be spick and span from inside. Because inside all the dhoop, it all makes it dark. So you have to clean it without taking the paint off. So then I have to organize all the brahmacharis. Some want to come, some don't want to come. Yet the job has to be done. So how do you inspire? All that happened. Before going to the ashram, money. That was there. So are we growing or are we stuck only in collecting? Or are we stuck only in becoming a community leader or a society, national leader? Because none of these roles are going to give you satisfaction if you don't keep going further. The next stage is what? Brahman. Kshatriya is the managing capacity. Next is Brahman. Who is this? He does not cry. He does not want anything for himself. He does not want to manage people. He leaves it to the Lord. Then what does he want to do? Huh? No. Brahman is who wants to merge into the Lord. Not just take the name. Merge into the Lord. He wants to realize that he and Lord are not separate. And in that journey, whatever qualities are required, either he tries to imbibe them or he knows that I don't have to run after these qualities. I'll just remember the Lord and hello. I will just surrender to the Lord and whatever qualities that are conducive for this journey, they will automatically come to me. And it does happen that way. So it is not that we were born as a sannyasi. You are not born reading Bhagavatam. Interest has developed over the period, over the years, isn't it? As a child, you did not know who Krishna was, you did not know who Shiva was, you did not know who Devi was, you did not know what Hinduism was or Christianity was, what Islam was. And the moment as you start growing, hey, main to, who are you? I am Hindu. Hey, teri ki? Paida hua tha Hindu ke hote hue. And we don't stop there. Yeah, I am a Hindu from Maharashtra and I am Kokanastha or Deshastha. I am a Ayyar or I am a Nayyar or I am a... Keep dividing yourself, keep defining yourself. True definition is not that. True definition should be on the Varnashram basis. Assess yourself, find out. If you are a lazy type, become active. If you are a greedy type, become more giving. It will take you to Kshatriya. If you are a managerial type, give up managering. Become God-oriented, knowledge-oriented. So that you, as long as an individual is there, Brahma, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra will be expressing. But you want to go beyond these. That's when the real journey begins. So what is sannyas? Sannyas is where you are neither of these four. In Sikh religion also, when they do, they give Gurmukh. Anyone who becomes Gurmukh, they are not allowed to call themselves, I am a Kshatriya, I am a Vaishya, I am a Brahmin. Otherwise, in Sikh people, because they were all Hindus only once upon a time. So many Sikhs I know, they call themselves, I am a Brahmin Sikh. I am a Kshatriya Sikh. But when they become Gurmukh, they are not allowed to say any, you cannot hold on to that classification. Even if they are marrying, they want their child to be married, they cannot say, oh, we were now I'm Gurmukh, but we were actually Brahman Sikh. So I want a girl from a Brahmin family. If that is the way you're looking, then you're going against being Gurmukh. You must melt into the totality. That is sannyas. So here he says that follow your dharma by taking refuge in me, varnashrama kulacharam, and according to your varnashram, do your duty. According to your kul, whatever family you have been born in, whatever the ways are there, you follow that. And akama atma samacharet, and akama, and become desire free. When we are doing our duty, we become, then there's no question. If I have to get up in the morning and take bath, then go to toilet, then brush my teeth, the other sequence. Huh? And they, what was I saying?
Shower, brush,
toilet, shower, wearing clothes, etc. You are not thinking. Are you thinking about it? It's automatic. Do you go to brush your teeth because, what will that girl who's sitting next to me in the office feel if I go without a brush? Do you think that way? I'm asking you. He works from home. See? So we are, then you get up in the morning like a small child. When he becomes 8 years, 7 years old, they are done Yajnapavit, the janeu dalte. And he's told, chant Bhurbhuvasvatatsavitur 21 times every day, do Sandhya Vandanam. He says, Mummy, what will I get from it? Because he's been trained that whatever you do, there is always a return. If you eat food, you will get good health. If you eat all the vegetables, you will not. Your immune system will be strong. If you vacuum the house, you will get $5. This is how we are training our children. But our culture is different. You do it because it is the right thing. So now 7 years old, childhood over, he's growing. Do Gayatri Mantra. Why, mommy? Because I say so. Because it is the right thing to be done. What will I get out of it? Nothing. What will I? But see, today in ashrams and other places, they teach. If you do Gayatri Mantra, you'll get very good intellect. You'll do this. The whole purpose is you have to do something without expecting anything in return. Because the result will be something or the other. There are many crooks who are chanting Gayatri Mantra also. They become very good crooks. Same way. So, he is told, so now to do Gayatri Mantra, he has to get up in the morning. See, you have to fill up your day. You got 24 hours. What are you going to do 24 hours? If you don't do it, your mind is going to go into unwanted areas of negativity. It is going to go into expectations. It will say, oh, I want to do this, I want to do that. How can I get money to do this? How can I manipulate this fellow to get this work done? Oh, water is leaking. How can I get that fixed without spending any money? This is how your mind will start working for everything. How I can use the world, how can I use my contacts to satisfy my desires. This is how it will go. But when we are following our swadharma and following the varnashrama, the purpose is to become desire free. You keep doing what is required to be done. Why? Because it is told in the scriptures, because it is the right thing to do. What will be the result? Don't worry about it. Yeah, here the word given is Samacharet. Do everything in your life with equanimity. Equanimity means there is no desire. Equanimity means there is no wish. Equanimity is there is no like or dislike. Equanimity means whatever the nature is prompting out of you, you are doing it. You are not doing it because you want to do it. इट इज नॉट द रीजन. वॉन्ट आ गया तो डिजायर हो गया ना. सो डू यू वॉन्ट हंगर टू कम और हंगर कम्स? कम्स. यू ओनली ऑब्जर्व दैट हंगर हैज कम एंड देन आफ्टरवर्ड्स यू से आई एम हंगरी, बट यू आर ऑब्जर्विंग हंगर इज कमिंग. लाइक आई केम, शी गेव मी अ होल बोल ऑफ पोहा एंड व्हाइल आई वॉज ईटिंग सडनली आई रियलाइज्ड आई वॉज सो हंगरी, बट टिल आई केम आई वॉज ओके. बट द मोमेंट आई पुट टू थ्री स्पून ऑफ इट इन साइड माई माउथ, सडनली आई सेड ओ माई गॉड आई वॉज सो हंगरी आई फिनिश द होल थिंग. सो दिस रिकॉग्निशन दैट वी गो थ्रू लाइफ, वर्ल्ड विल कंटिन्यूसली थ्रो समथिंग और द अदर फॉर यू टू डू, फॉर दिस इक्विपमेंट बॉडी ब्रेथ माइंड इंटेलेक्ट टू डू. लेट इट हैपन बट यू रिमेन डिजायर फ्री. इफ यू आर डूइंग दिस वेरी क्विकली यू विल बिकम प्यूरिफाइड. वेयर? इन योर माइंड. दिस ब्रिंग्स अबाउट प्यूरिफिकेशन. कंटिन्यूइंग इन द सेकेंड वर्स ही सेज, अन्वीक्षेत विशुद्धात्मा देहिनाम विषयात्मनाम गुणेषु तत्वध्यानेन सर्वारंभ विपर्ययम्. He says, having thus purified his mind. How do you purify mind? How do you purify your mind? I just told. Answer.
Just aim one step higher than where you
are. No. Without expecting. How do you purify your mind? Doing all the duties without any expectation is the first step. But here, that comes in Bhagavad Gita chapter 2. There it comes. First step is do what is required to be done without expectation. Second is some purification happens. Then it comes to the attitude. Then it comes to the karma, akarma, akarma in karma. And then comes karma sannyas. These are the four steps. First five chapters of second, third, fourth, fifth. And then alone the sixth chapter meditation begins. When mind is sufficiently purified. But here, those steps are not given. Here it is told, akama atma samacharet. Akama atma. Let the self remain desire free. Let the self remain samacharet, equanimous, while it is performing through the body, through the equipment, it is performing the actions. So, again, I'm asking the question, how does purification happen in the light of this? Say confidently, yaar. Khur nahi chahiye. Remaining equanimous and desire, and only when you are desire free, you will be equanimous while performing the actions. So straight away, you will not become equanimous. But you have intention should be that way, that I am not getting involved in activity because of a desire. Let it be a personal desire, let it be a worldly desire, selfish or worldly. We can sometimes say, oh, I am not doing it for myself, I am doing it for the family. I am not doing it for the family, Gandhiji said, I am doing it for the nation, and got 2 million people killed. It's wrong. So you can't shoot a gun by, I'm not doing it for myself. No, you want to get out of myself and you want to get out from the idea that I'm doing it for the world also. But it happens slowly. So here he says, having thus purified his mind. So, living like this with extreme alertness and vigilance, that no action happening out of this equipment is desire prompted. Then what about need? It will automatically be taken care of. It will automatically be taken care of. I didn't know. that I was going to get poha. I didn't even know that I was hungry. Forget about poha. See? Whatever is in your destiny, it will come to you. And whatever is not in your destiny, even if you desire, it will not come to you. But are you, if you really, really desire and you create the reality for yourself according to your desire, are you ready to pay the consequences? Like Ravan? Like Kans? See? So you want a wholesome growth. You don't want to be my way or the highway. I have decided, I am going my way. That's it. No. You want to melt into that, as I was telling her in the car, unifying principle. That unifying is the Atma. That unifying is the Lord. And that Lord alone is appearing as, expressing as Atma within us. So whether you go, you are, here the word used was Sva, the word Sva. So Swadharma is talked about when you as an individual, self. But Sva is not individual, Sva is Sva, Sva is self. But when you add Dharma to it, it becomes the duty of a person. You understand? But Sva is independent. So here he says, Dehi Naam Vishayatmanam. Having purified the mind thus, he should observe how the actions of worldly men attached to sense pleasures, who consider them to be real, produce contrary results, cause and misery. So now you don't have to accept this, Krishna Bhagavan is telling Uddhav. You don't have to accept. Majority of the people don't want to accept. You observe your own life, not someone else's life. See, smart people, who are smart people? Like us. Learn from other people's mistakes. What is other people's mistake? You got married, I didn't get married. You have children, I don't have children. I play with your children. Huh? Today when I met someone from India called, SMS'd me, Swamiji, you know, our classmate from year 8, he is living in Melbourne. So I called him this morning, yesterday night, evening, or this morning. I said, hey, Paul, he's Anglo-Indian. His father was Air Marshal. And I said, hey, Paul, remember, and we used to do lot of, we used to carry the, he had an air gun because Air Marshal, he can have air gun. And he used to have, we used to have the swords. And we used to take the lasso and we used to go and catch vultures. And we'll go into the house cause, you know, the khandar hote the na. Khandar ko kya bolte hai? Ruins. And we'll go and explore all of them. Because we have knife, we are not afraid. And we're only 11 year old, Saket's age. And we used to go with a gun in hand, in the bus. And I, hey, remember Navi, my name? And he said, yeah, I remember. Who's, where's the third fellow? I said, he's in Delhi. We want to remember these memories. We want to remember, immediate connection with that person. But now it is this connection. That time he was my bestest friend. We three were inseparable in the school. But what happened? He went his way. The other one went his way. This fellow went his way. That child, if you take from her hand that doll which she's carrying. Last class I was doing it. She was having this doll. No, she was having that smiley face, was yellow smiley face on the fridge. So she was looking at it. So I picked her up, I showed it to her. I didn't give it to her, I put her down. I took the smiley face and I showed it to her. And she went to catch it, I put it in my pocket. The moment I put it in my pocket, she's full, no tears, but crying fully. And I did 2-3 times. I was enjoying myself seeing her cry. Huh? And then after some time, when some crocodile tears had come out, not that she knows that it is crocodile tears, she's, in the end she started really crying. Then I gave it to her. And she was happy. And after 10 seconds, she threw it away and she was playing with something else. But at that time, because she did not get it, how miserable she was. When we don't get something in life which we desire, how miserable we become. And after we get it, how long do you enjoy it? How long do you enjoy it? When you got this house, I came here when you built. Oh, wonderful. Now, how many things are breaking down? This is breaking down. Iska kharcha hai, uska kharcha hai, iska kharcha hai. It's a never-ending thing. So observe in your life, whether it is thoughts, whether it's your attachments, whether it's your desires, what desires you had at 1 year old or 4 year old or 10 year old or 15 year old or 20, 30, 40, are they still there with you? Some of them may have stayed, but majority of them have left you because you got the temporary joy that you needed to get and you have moved on to higher desires or more miserable desires to create more misery. Because that much was not enough. Ha bail mujhe mar. See?
Yay.
So observe. So who is a smart... So why are memories given to us? Not to indulge. What do we do? We have got... we put the... some houses we go on the TV. From childhood, the pictures are going on of the children, then the from the marriage, then when your mother was pregnant, then the child was there, newly born. Like that, whose birthday was yesterday? Anubhav's. He's carrying, the moment he was born from his mother's womb, they had taken a photograph. And in his pocket, he's carrying that photograph. Swamiji, me. And I said, hey, dirty fellow, don't show me this. No, no, it's me. I said, you're still dirty. Throw. So imagine again and again you are showing him that photograph. What is happening? He's getting attached to the form. Whom should we get him attached to? He's now 8 years old. To the Lord. Are we giving him that training? They are giving, I know. But that is wrong. So if we know that in our life nothing has given us permanent happiness, all our actions have only generated even more actions, even more insecurity, even more desires, then I must be going wrong somewhere. I have to correct this journey. Some aspect of it I have to change. So now, lucky we have memory. Use your memory to look into the past. Not to indulge, but to learn from it and do not correct and not to make the same mistakes now. So memory is not given for any other purpose but for learning. If you have learnt, then what will happen? Tell me. If you have learnt the lesson, what will happen? Huh?
Never repeat it.
Never repeat it? Okay. What else will happen? Huh? Memory itself is an impression. So how can memory leave an impression? Memory itself is an impression. But if you have learned from the memory, what will happen to the memory? It stops having a sway on you. You understand the word? You stop being a slave of that memory because you have used it for the right purpose. You have learned the lesson. Now that memory does not hold power over you anymore. You understand? Now this statement is not just to get a nod from you. You look into your life. There are so many memorable, how many things you think about? Through your entire life? Hardly. Only where your mind is still stuck, some desire unfulfilled, there only your mind memory, that memory gets invoked, isn't it? Not everything. So in this way, perform actions according to your knowledge, according to your karma. That is depend, and you find out from yourself, where do you stand? Just because you can think doesn't mean you have become Brahman. See? Just because you can think and read scriptures doesn't mean you have become Brahmin. Just because Vishwamitra was a Kshatriya, and because he had all the powers and he created a heaven, that did not make him into a Brahmin. He was still a Raja Rishi. He did not become a Brahmin. When did he become Brahmin? Only when he surrendered to sage Vasishtha. Then he became the final consummation. The ego, he allowed his ego to be completely gone. Then Brahmanatva expressed out of him. And that was not him saying, I have become Brahma Rishi now. Other people said, this fellow has become Brahma Rishi. When he completely annihilated himself as a person. Until unless you as an individual don't completely finish yourself off thinking of sleep, till then sleep is not there, isn't it? Same way. So these stages of purification of Brahma, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra, wherever you are, don't try to be a thinker when your propensity is to work in the fields. Enjoy that, do that correctly. See, our Kabir Das Ji, who was he? He was a weaver, isn't it? He did not say, I got siddhis and Lord comes and gives me darshan. So, I think I should stop weaving because this is a Vaishya job. It's a... now I think I have become Brahmin. This is how we are all thinking. You keep doing where life has placed you. He continued weaving till the end. And with that weave, chak, 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 every thread that used to go in, Ram, 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 and became a realized master. So what is... And here we are thinking, apne aapko 30 marks ka samajhte hain, ki we are this, we are that, because we are born in a Brahmin family, we are Brahmin, but what do? Eat meat and drink. What lakshanas are there of Brahmin? Zero. He should observe how the actions of worldly men attached to sense pleasures, who consider them to be real, produce contrary results. If I love eating, I have desired, desire gives me happiness. Okay, what do you desire now? I desire gulab jamun. So I am going to eat gulab jamun. I eat one, I eat two, I eat three. But by the time fourth one comes, the tongue is saying, I want, but the mind is saying, enough. Tummy is not right. But still, I'll take the fifth one. The tongue says, I don't know if I'll get it again. But the mind is saying, you're going to puke. So, you began that if I get gulab jamun, I'll be happy. By the 6th, 7th gulab jamun, you don't want to think also about gulab jamun for next 1 year. Why? It made you vomit. So did that desire give you happiness or did that desire give you misery? Think. Oh, it gave happiness in the beginning, but it concluded in misery. But if I had not gone till the 7th one, if I had eaten only one, then it was happiness, wasn't it? It was. But how long? How long? 1 second? 1 minute? 2 minutes? After that, next question is, acha, ab gulab jamun taste kare, ab kya? Oh, barfi. Then after that what? Puri. After that what? Get married. After that what? Have children. After that what? Get a job. After that what? Wait for retirement. You see? There is no end to this. Learn. Learn from your own experience. Smart person is who learns from other people's experiences. Even smarter person is who learns from his own experiences. And the bestest person is who remains equanimous through all the experiences. Then purification happens. So what is stopping you from What is the anomaly between you and God? What is the, why you are not able to become one with the world? See, when you want to come with your, with someone, if I meet him, I say, how do we become one? By hugging, isn't it? But that hugging is, for that 1 second we hug, the distance is gone, a sense of bliss comes, but very next moment again separation happens, isn't it? How can I remain hugging to the world permanently? How? If I keep desiring one thing, then next thing, then next thing, then next thing, rest of the world is still waiting to be hugged. I'm only hugging one desire. Is there a way I can hug the entire world in one go? Then there will be true fulfillment, isn't it? That is only possible when in your mind you come to realize that this world is not other than God. And that God is in my heart. And if I, just like I surrender to sleep and go to sleep, if I surrender to Lord and the Lord consumes me, then when I come out of that samadhi or meditation, when I look out, I'll see the eyes are seeing the world, the names, forms, words, etc. But my heart is at one with the entire world. Without doing anything. Just like without doing anything, you feel like one with your children. You don't see that they are separate to you. You know they are separate. Yes, physically they are separate. But somewhere inside the connection is there, isn't it? Imagine you have that connection with the entire world. It's overwhelming. That's consummation. And then, where are we? Contraries, cause are of no value. The third verse says, Suptasya vishayaloko dhyayato vamanorathaha nanatmakatvad vifalaha tatha bhedatmadhir gunaihi. The third, as the dreams of a sleeping person and the fancies of one drowned in a reverie are of no value, being of a diversified character, so is the notion of differences produced by the gunas illusory. So what are the gunas? Up, down, east, west. Are the directions real? Are the directions real? Is the imagination? Oh, see, even imagination, if you are sitting here and imagining, I climbed the, where did we go in Sri Lanka? To the Hanuman's foot on the top of the mountain where he landed. And we've reached the hotel, we took shower, we didn't think about sleep or rest. We were so excited to start the journey. 12 o'clock. We started the journey, 5 o'clock for sunrise, we were up there, and then we reached there, we looked at the feet of Hanumanji, and then we came out, we chanted few times the Hanuman Chalisa. It was so fulfilling. Just the thought of that makes you blissful, isn't it? Now imagine, second imagination, you are sitting, I went to Trimbakeshwar. And I was all excited. And I wanted to have the darshan of the Lord. But outside the pandas caught me. And they said, oh, before you go there, you have to take bath in the kund. And they were not leaving me. And they said, oh, we told you to go and take bath. So give us dakshina. Then next one came. I will do the puja for you. Give me dakshina. Then what will happen? You know, you went there for darshan of the Lord in the mind itself. But where are you caught up? In the negative thoughts. In the previous one, you are caught up in the positive thoughts. Which is going to give you bliss? The positive one, naturally. So if you know thinking positive gives you bliss, why don't you move around in your daily life with positive thoughts? Simple conclusion. Don't judge, don't pass comments, don't create likes and dislikes, don't hate. Just go through life. Whoever comes in your life, you are not demanding who is, I don't know that you are going to come, but whoever comes. Yesterday one person came and I had not met him at all. He, his wife, his child, and they came to Australia. He worked for 3-4 months and then he got depressed and he went back to India, was hospitalized and is still on antidepressants. And I had a good laugh, because that is the worst present you can give to yourself, depression. It is self-inflicted. It's all because your mind is not in the right place. It's going into pity, it's going into comparison, it's going into competition, it's going into I'm not good enough, it's going into complexes, it's going into why me? Why I have to get, why I came to Australia for a better future, why am I not getting a job? There's no why. You have to keep trying, that's all. But you have created the speed of this why me, the self-pity, so much, the speed is so much that it has brought about a downward spiral. That downward spiral within your mind of negativity, of negative thoughts with no solution, is called depression. And that medicine that he is taking is not going to solve it. It's only superficial. Then what to do? Same thing I told him. Not because I had read this chapter, I read it today. You perform every action out of joy. Every action must be an expression of joy. Even if you are getting angry, be a joyfully angry. He has learned that. How he learned it? Because he used to pick me up to take me to the lecture in such a temple. So over 1 year he learned the lesson. Theek bol raha na? But he did it. He applied it. Now nothing disturbs. The wife can keep screaming. So every action must be an expression of joy. Every thought must be an expression of joy. Every memory must be an expression of joy. If you want to indulge, if you want to bring it in front to learn, joyfully interact with it so that you can learn something out of it. But yahan pe you go the other way, immediately it becomes a downward spiral. Anything goes into a down, you know, the whirlpool, anything falls into it, it gets sucked to the bottom. If you are not joyfully expressing in your life, the only other way is getting sucked into the other end. So be alert. And the best way to do that, take the Lord's name, remember the Lord. So here he says that as the dreams of a sleeping person and the fancies of, so here you also see everything that is happening in the dream. You see that you were joyful, you were hungry, you were thirsty, your desires were satisfied, then they were, but when you wake up, what happens to the entire dream? What happens? Zero. No value whatsoever. If that is what is going to happen, if you merge into the Lord, start living with giving no value to this world. If that is where your destination is. No, but you said that this world is God. This world is not other than God. Then how can I not give value? Then give value to the God which is present in this world. Not to the people, not to the form, not to what you see, hear, touch, feel, taste. Give value to the essence. What do you give value to here? You give value to the light or you give value to the bulb? Light. You don't say, hey, bulb kitna achha hai. Do you say this bulb is so bright? Or do you say light is so bright? Light is so bright. So your attention is on the principle called light. Your attention is not on the bulb and its wattage, but its expression. But we don't follow that rule when you're looking at people. We're not looking at the life which is expressing. We are looking at the bulb. This person is like this, that person is like this, this is like that. We are not talking about the life which is expressing out of it and becoming blissful about it. See, this may, the angry bliss is coming out of here. See, the jealousy bliss is coming out of here. See, this comparison bliss is coming out of here. Male bliss, female bliss. So our attention is not on the principle. Our attention is on the form. So here, just like when you woke up, you gave zero value to all the forms and all the experiences in the dream. If that is what eventually is going to happen, and it is happening, when you go to sleep, you give zero value to all the forms and experiences of the waking, isn't it? That is your experience. You don't carry all that with you to the sleep. Start living like that. If eventually you have to let them go, stop. Why do you want to be persecuted by them? Why not, instead of this tug of war with the memories, tug of war with wanting to continue yesterday into today, the tug of war in wanting to satisfy your desires with, one person is there, he says, Swamiji, I think I'm almost realized, but I know one thing is, two things are left to be done. And I will not get realized till those two things are not done. He doesn't understand that he goes after one, it will create another 10, 100. So he's living in a fool's world. I'm almost realized. Only these two things. That's it. And those two things have remained two things since I've known him. But it always ends in two things. So if this one thing out of those two gets resolved, again another two will be there. Because that's my observation from last 15 years, 20 years. Watch yourself. Have you become desire-free after having satisfied your desires? Remember the topic of the chapter, the emptiness of earthly and otherworldly enjoyments. So don't go after these temporary joys born out of satisfaction of your desire. Let the joy be expressed of the one. Hold on to that one, which can never be denied, which can never be negated, which is always. If your attention is on that God principle, whether one bulb fuses or 100 bulb fuses, the principle of light continues. Whether previous body vanished, this body has come, this will vanish. If there is a next body, if that comes and vanishes, me as the person, life, who is expressing through this body, is a continuous principle. Recognize this about yourself. World also, continuously everything is breaking down and something new is getting created. Every moment. But the life that is expressing in this world is permanent. Isn't it? Just like space is permanent, without space, world cannot be there. Go one step further. Without God, space cannot be there. Continuing. we are in the fourth verse. Nivrittam karma seveta pravrittam mat parastyajet jignyasayam sampravritto nadriyet karma chodanam. In the fourth verse he says, one who is devoted to me should perform all obligatory or occasional duties, but should forsake all actions prompted by desire. If one is fully engaged in an inquiry into the self, he need not attend even to the prescribed duties. Why do we attend to prescribed duties? So that we do not become lazy. If you are not busy, you will be lazy. And one must be active in life. And active not for the sake of activity. Activity done with diligence, with perfection, with joy, with awareness, that type of activity. It will lead to purification. It will lead to purification. And when all that activity, just now I gave you the example of thinking good thoughts, that was activity in your mind, isn't it? What is Manas Puja? Shiva Manas Puja. What is it? It is thinking of not doing any physical activity, but doing the puja in your mind. You know, when I think Dinesh and Seema came with me to Maharashtra, you were there, Maharashtra? When we were at Vani Devi, we are chanting the Lalita Sahasranam up there. I had the booklet and we got the right next to the Sanctum Sanctorium we were sitting, all the whole group. And full on, full throttle, the Lalita Sahasranam was going on. I also started. But after 2-3 verses, my eyes just got pulled in looking at the Devi. And I said, forget it, I'm not going to chant. If it is not happening, let it not happen. I was looking at the Devi, there's the tongue coming out like this one, the red tongue, very bhayankar. But in that moment, my eyes got pulled and I went into meditation. And in meditation, a small young girl like her, in Pavda, she appeared in my mind. And I did the entire, while Sahasranam is going on, I'm watching that it is happening. The entire 16 step puja happened to that girl. Entire 16 step puja. And I was not involved in it. I am not thinking, now I have to put chandan, now I have to put kunku, now I have to put akshata, now I have to put mala. No, everything is happening. I am watching. Manasa puja. So, coming back to the point, why do we do nitya karma? Nitya karma means daily prescribed duties. What are the daily prescribed duties? Get up in the morning at Brahma Muhurt, do your pranayama meditation, wash yourself, clean yourself, bathe yourself, do some chanting, read one or two verses of Bhagavad Gita, sit in meditation doing japa and then allow yourself to be absorbed in meditation. This is your prescribed duty. Then after that, what happens? Then you have to go to work. That is a part of the duty. Go for that, but do that work as an offering to the divine. Then come back from work. And what do you do at work? Whatever you do, do it joyfully. Today, everywhere we hear, I don't like what I do. I want to do what I love. I am inspired about. But Bhagavad Gita says, you love what you are doing. Don't do what you love. See? If I'm sitting here, I don't love talking. And then, see? So wherever life has placed you, whatever job life has placed you, whatever circumstances life has placed you, enjoy. Don't have a reaction to it. Then you are going into the negative spiral. You want the positive spiral. Think positively. How you can benefit. How you can add value. It's not about me anymore when you are out there in the world. It was about me when I was in the morning till I went to work. It was about me. So I created the foundation. I established myself in it. But when I go out there in the world, now it's about the world. It's about the boss. It's about the fellow employees. It's about the employer. It's about the government. It's whatever. Do what is right. Joyfully. Without creating conflict in your mind. Your mind in all interactions out there in the world must remain equanimous. If it is losing that plot, you will come back home a disturbed person. Suppose it has happened. You got disturbed while you were out there in the world. Come back home, prescribed duty. Come back home, again, whatever by mistake you reacted, offer it again to the Lord. Again, sit for meditation to calm your mind down. Do your japa, read the scriptures. Fill up your time. Not watching TV and serials and etc. etc. Fill up your time by interacting with the divine, because that divine alone is complete. We have just assessed that all my memories, all my desires only give me temporary joy. So why not I have desire for that who is complete? So then I'll get complete joy. Permanent joy. This is nitya karma. Then rule is again, many people who are doing nitya karma, like once in, when we finished our course, we were going around India and some brahmacharis from our class, they were traveling with me in the train. These buggers, early in the morning, 3:30, Brahma Murt Utna, because we had just finished the course. We used to get up at 3:30, 4 o'clock. So in the train also they are getting at 3:30, 4 o'clock. And disturbing everyone who is sleeping there. And they went into the toilet and why? Oh, Brahma Murt mein snan karna hai. They took water and finished all the water in the toilet. Now others, the whole bogie is there. They want to go to toilet but no water. This is not nitya karma. This is stupidity. So, No, but we have to follow the prescribed rules and duties we have to do. Then stay at home. Don't get in your home, follow 100%. When you're outside your... Hey! Shh! Lavanya! Shh! Good. Flying kiss also. I got it written. Coffee cat hai. Sochti nahi hogi. Seedha de diya. So when you are at home, follow 100% of rules and regulations. When you are outside, follow 50%. When you are traveling. When you are in someone else's house, follow 25%. When we are with the master, follow 0%. Do what he says. He says, okay, brahmachari, let's have breakfast. Swamiji, abhi tak nahe nahi. Kya farak padta hai nahana hai nahi na? Chalo breakfast karte hai. Nahi, main nahi. I follow my rules. Till I don't take, brush my teeth and don't take shower, till then I don't take breakfast. Acha, tu mat khao, main kha lunga. He will eat. No rules when you are with the master. No, but then this is, it is not right. Then stay at home. Don't go and disturb the world for necessary. Because we compromise the rules when we are at home. When we are at other people's house, we demand more. Have you noticed? I do like this only. I don't eat that. I do that. Hey, tiriki. तो यहाँ पे ये लिखा है कि one who is devoted to me should perform all obligatory duties and occasional duties, but should forsake all actions prompted by desires. I have already talked about this, that do not live a desire-oriented life. Desire-oriented life means, did I have a desire to come here to give lecture? Did you have a desire to come here and listen to the lecture? Think about it. Or did I come and you come because it's the right thing to do? That you have to determine in your mind. See? So where there is satsang, it is the right thing to do. Desire for the higher is righteous automatically. Desire for the lower takes you away from the divine. If one is fully engaged in inquiry into the self, he need not attend even to his prescribed duties. So we are lost, you know. You see the pujaris. Yesterday somewhere I was. The puja was doing. Havan was happening. And after Havan, I don't understand all this. He was giving water. After every step they have to wash hands again and again and again, and I did not understand. And this fellow who was doing the puja, he forgot. Hey, the pujari, hey, wash the hand quickly. So many do's and don'ts. When you are doing havan, when you are doing puja, if you do not follow everything to the T, the puja or the havan is not fruitful. Not just the activity of how to place everything everywhere, how to wash, what mantras to be chanted, the right intonation, all those things. So instead of God, you are only lost in, I have to wash hands after every thing. You are lost in, I have to chant this mantra. Arey, yaar, I forgot again, I have to start again. You know, have you noticed when we are doing havan, and if suddenly some mistake is there, again they chant some kshama prartha, and then again they begin the japa or giving of the ahuti. And it sometimes it happens 5-10 times, because how many times you will keep asking forgiveness? Now how do you go beyond this? A point must come. A point must come in your doing this puja that enough, man. This I cannot get become perfect at it. My purpose is not to do the action correct. My purpose is to merge into the divine. I want to become, I want to give my ahuti into the fire. I want to give the ahuti of my mind into the fire. And these dravya, these ingredients are just a pratik, are just a, kya bolte hai, pratik ko? Symbol. But we get lost in the symbol and mind remains there only. See? When that starts happening, you forget. Automatically, in the middle of the puja, if your attention is on the offering of the mind, merging of the mind into the Lord, while doing the puja, in the middle of the puja, you will go into meditation. In the middle of the puja, you will start doing japa. Then what he's saying? That if one is fully engaged in the inquiry or in the japa or in the union with the divine, then he need not even attend to his prescribed duties. Then whether he does puja, whether he does his duty towards the family, whether he does his duty towards the world, whether he goes to work or doesn't go to work, it does not matter. Why? Why? Because he cherishes his union with the divine more than he cherishes his contact with the world. That is why. But it takes time. For some people, it's like that. One click and it's gone. It's like a lightning. But lightning comes and goes. You want consummation. For some people, it happens that way. For some people, see, like the Eknath Maharaj. You have heard of Eknath Maharaj? Eknath Maharaj wrote an extensive commentary on this 11th chapter canto of Bhagavatam. Extensive commentary. Because in this canto, all the methods, all the sadhana is given how to merge into the divine. And Tukaram Maharaj, who came much after, he did parayan after parayan after parayan and understood and practiced it in his life, and he became God, became merged into the God. just by doing parayana of this 11th canto. Parayana, understand, na? Chanting. See, if you are, I don't understand Sanskrit, you don't have to understand Sanskrit. You do the chanting of Bhagavad Gita from the heart, that it is divine, it is the Lord's words. The words will strike meaning in your heart. You don't have to listen to anyone. You only listen to someone because you are incapable of getting your own meaning. But to get that meaning, you have to see that those words are the words of the Lord. You have to fall in love with the Lord. And Tukaram did that. One after another, few, I don't know how many. And the whole knowledge became Tukaram's. In the fifth verse, so nivrittam karma seveta, very literally speaking, nivritti pravritti. Pravritti is involvement, nivritti is withdrawal. So nivrittam karma seveta, so I am serving those karmas which help me to withdraw from the world, help me to withdraw into the divine. Pravrittim mat parastyajet, and pravrittim, those thoughts, those activities which make me get involved in the world, I tyajet, I renounce. This is your decision. You are an intelligent person. You got an intellect which discriminates. To discriminate, which activity is going to take you towards the Lord, which activity is going to take you away from the Lord, which thought is going to take you towards the Lord, which thought is going to take you away from the Lord, which bhavana or desire is going to take you towards the Lord, which bhavana or desire is going to take you away from the Lord. Be alert about it. This is happening every moment. The price is vigilance that you have to pay. It's only a question of alertness, that's all. Then he says, Yamana bhikshanam seveta niyamana matpara kvachit madbhignyam gurum shantam upasitam adatmakam. In the sixth verse he says that, no, fifth verse we are doing, no? Oh, we forgot. Correct, is it? Fifth one, he says, my votary should devoutly practice austerities and at times observe sacred vows too, and he should wait upon his preceptor of tranquil mind who has realized me as identical with myself. See? Yeah, the words used are yama and niyama. Yama anabhiksham bhikshanam seveta. Seveta, serve. Serve what? The yamas. What are the yamas? Yamas are, is that disposition of yours in the world practicing which you do not get disturbed by anything in the world, nor you get disturb the world. And these are in everyone, naturally. Your conscience will tell you. And yamas are five. They are ahimsa, satya, asteya, aparigraha, and brahmacharya. Ahimsa is non-violence. Satya is truthfulness. Then third is asteya, not stealing things from others, even ideas. Patents also. China is very adept at it. Aparigraha, non-accumulation. And fifth one, brahmacharya. These five you have to practice. The niyamas, they are natural. These five you have to practice consciously, that not to be violent by thought, word and deed. Second one, satya, that be committed to the truth. never deviate from the truth, and that truth, recognize that truth as the self, recognize that truth as the Paramatma, that recognize that truth as the foundation of life itself. But if you take it at a general level, truth is speaking the truth. Speaking the truth, what is speaking the truth? This is a book. Is this truth? Yes. But Jnaneshwar Maharaj or someone, I can't remember who, he explains truth in a different way. He says, those words which do not hurt another person, even if they are lie, are truth. Those words which do not disturb the person's joy or create agitation in another mind. So now you watch, when someone dies and we have to go and tell a small child or the father or the mother or whoever the relatives are, very gently we expose it to them, isn't it? We don't go say, hey, you know what? Mar gaya. Aise thoda na bolte hain. You will go there, some people express it by crying. Arre kyun, kya kar? You don't speak. They come to the conclusion by themselves that something has happened. And you still not answering, telling them what has happened. They start vocalizing. And when they hit the right one, you stop breathing. They know. Isn't it? So what is that? So you did not say anything. Or sometimes we say, you know, something bad has happened to that person, to your son. What has happened? No, something bad. I don't know how to say, I don't know how to express this, that. They're looking at all the various options are going through their mind. And when they come to the point, they don't want to come to that conclusion that he has passed away. But when you are not saying yes to any one of those options, and they say, has he had an accident? You don't say he has had an accident. You say he's gone to heaven. Isn't it? Positive. You don't say he went to hell because he took two with him. You don't speak that way. So, what is satya? Satya is that speech, those type of thoughts which do not create agitation in another person, restlessness in another person. Always use such speech that it calms them down. Third one is aparigraha, asat asteya. Asteya means stealing. No stealing, not calling other people's thing as mine. Self-explanatory. Then fourth is aparigraha, non-accumulation. Not accumulating things in this world, portfolios in this world, relationships in this world, but also not accumulating memories. Live in the present moment. For whom are these points given? For that person who wants the Lord and Lord alone. Why you want the Lord? Because he is the only one who can give me permanent bliss. Unchanging happiness he can give me. And the last one is brahmacharya. Brahmacharya means utilizing all, conserving all your energy and directing it towards the higher goal. And where is the energy? It is your vitality, it is your speech, it is what you see, hear, touch, feel, taste, it is your mind, it is your convictions, it is your feelings. All of them are directed towards that one divine. That's brahmacharya. Charya means to walk. The one who is walking the path to God is brahmachari. And when that brahmachari has harnessed all the energies, just like when you want to buy a house, he is buying one, building one. So he has saved all the money, he has taken the loan. Swamiji, you have anything, take from me also. Vinay, you have something, take from him also. He'll ask everyone if he's having no shame. But within his means, he will make sure that every dollar which is unused is utilized for one goal, isn't it? He has harnessed all his resources so that his project becomes fructified. So who's Brahmachari? Who harnesses all his energies to fructify his merging into the divine. Understand? And what is that merging into the divine? He cannot merge, but he becomes available with that energy. So that he goes and he knocks on the door, and like sleep consumes you, the Lord says, come on in, man. But to get there, you need the energy. That's why a very common example, for a rocket to leave the gravitational force of the earth, a humongous amount of energy is required to generate a particular speed, and that speed is 11 kilometers per second. Per second or per microsecond, something like that. You must be knowing more. If it doesn't reach that speed, 11 kilometers per second, it cannot break through the gravitational pull of the earth. That's why so many rockets are added, three stages. So imagine you are in the gravitational pull of your body. Forget the earth, body is our earth. I am the body, I was born, I am going to die. My children, my wife, my hunger, my thirst, my heart. My asthma, my headache, everything body only. To get out of this gravitational pull, the brahmachari needs, the seeker needs to harness all his energies in order to shoot out of it. When he shoots out, what happens? Once you get out of the gravitational sphere of the earth, do you need that much energy? Do you need that much energy? The moment the rocket goes outside the gravitational orbit, all the engines stop and it glides with the momentum without utilizing any energy. Same way, once you get into the meditative state, you don't need this energy anymore. This energy is required to be harnessed only to get out of body identification. Body means not just physical body, body, breath, mind, intellect. You have to get out of the mind also. Where are we? And niyama are how do we interact with ourselves? These are the ways. They are shaucha, santosha, tapasa, swadhyaya, ishwar, pranidhana. Shaucha, cleanliness. Santosh, contentment. Tapas, austerity. Swadhyaya, regular practice of the self. Regular remembering the self. Ishwar, pranidhana means remembering the Lord again and again. Now, lot of people, rather than the first step, they become to the third, second. They practice niyama very diligently. And they get lost in this. They'll get lost in cleaning the kitchen. They get lost in taking three times bath. They get lost in cleaning the house three times a day. By doing all this cleaning, God is not going to come. More important than this cleaning and this the tapas and swadhyaya and ishwar pranidhana, practice the first five. These other five, the niyama, will automatically come to you if you are God oriented. Automatic. As the advent of divine pervades your mind, you want to be the best for him then. Just like when you go to the temple, you want to be the best when you go into the temple. See, not like unlike you. They came to a holy place. See, clean clothes, clean good sari, fresh lungi, but old t-shirt. Here, where is our attention? On the outside. But nobody said, Samiji, it's the attitude that matters. So, example is, just like we show out the best of ourselves outwardly when we go to the temple, let's automatically, I offer my best when I'm in the presence of the divine, when I'm thinking of the divine, when I'm in love with the divine. See? So I'm coming to you. I will never come in, what do you call it? Surgal lelo ko kya bolte hai? Crushed. Huh? Crinkled clothes. Crinkled clothes. Crinkled? Huh? Crumpled clothes. Crumpled clothes. I should try once and see the reaction. But always, I want to be, I feel good. And I want to be seen as good, at least at that level. And same way with the words also. Same way with the disposition also. Same way with the feelings also. So these automatically, when your love for the divine is so intense, all these qualities of niyamas. Niyama is where you interact with yourself. Yama is when you are interacting with the world. Niyama is when you are interacting with yourself in your mind or in your body. Automatically they get perfected when you are offering it, offering yourself to the Lord. Next one, sixth verse. अमान्य मत्सरो दक्षो निर्ममो दृढ़ सौहृदः असत्वरोर्थ जिज्ञासु अनसूयूरमोघवाक् अरे बट आई फॉरगॉट दिस वन मदभिज्ञम गुरुम शांतम उपासीत मदात्मकम ओन वी मस्ट अप्रोच अ टीचर व्हेन When we must approach a teacher? Huh? Arre, one guru has come to the Australia. Bulao sabko. Let's go for darshan. How should you approach a teacher? Unprepared. How do you approach the God when you go to the temple? Unprepared. You prepare, spend so many, you plan, isn't it? Saturday is coming, Guru Purnima is there, or some festival is there, Ram Navami is there, or Krishna Janmashtami, I have to go to the temple. You are planning. And on that day, you are at the best. What is your best when you approach a teacher? These 10 points. Yama Niyama. Majority of the people in life, seekers, they do not practice these two. They only lost in puja, but are angry dogs after the puja is over or japa is over, with no feeling of no feeling of maturity or absorption into the divine. Only anger after puja. See? If we have gone to satsang, if we have gone to puja, if we have done meditation, our disposition should be saumya. Saumya means it should be pleasing afterwards. Because we have become empty. If that is the sadhu bhav, that is the that is the purification that has taken place. It has made you that one. Half an hour, 1 hour of going to a satsang, going to a temple, going to a japa or doing some bhajan or sitting in meditation, you must come out of it a better person. But is that happening? Immediately after the satsang, after the japa, bark here, bark there, comment here, argue there, discuss there. No. there should be a smile, there should be an unalloyed joy after your interaction in meditation with the Lord. So these are the parameters with which you check yourself. Am I going in the right direction? If this is not happening, where did I go wrong in my meditation? Was I desiring too much? Was I expecting too much, which has created this agitation in me? Am I expecting something, experience, and that experience is not happening, and that is frustrating me? No expectations. Go empty, come out empty. Same way you approach a teacher being empty. So here it is told. So these, the first half of the verse, Yamana Bhikshanam Seveta Niyamana Matpara Kwachit. Kwachit means it's okay, you can practice it. But if you are committed to the Lord, these niyama will automatically come about. And with this purification, with this internal adjustment in your outward behavior and your inward behavior with yourself, you approach a teacher. And which teacher? Which guru? The guru who is abiding in the self. Such a guru. And you will never come to know who is. You have to go with faith. Then you are benefiting yourself. Otherwise you go, oh, I think he is not a realized person, I will not go to him. And then I will wait for that person. But a realized person, do they come to Australia? Do they come? If you are going into this, what has happened? You have moved away from the Lord in your heart because you have gone into judgment. You pray. Learn from wherever. Dattatreya Maharaj. Don't get stuck in one box that I am only this. Dattatreya did not allow him to get stuck, himself to be stuck. He learned from everything. Then who is? Tell me. Who is the guru who is established in himself? Who is the guru? I'm asking you. Can you make that statement about any person out there? It will always be with a doubt, isn't it? Even the greatest of greatest sage, they get recognized only afterwards. Some of them during. But still, more people are not believing them. Then which is that guru who is established in his own self and you have access to him all the time? In your heart. The Sadguru in your heart. The Sadguru in your heart. And that Sadguru, if you keep touching him, calling him out, surrendering to him, he will bring about the teachers from whom you can learn, whom you can, you know, fine-tune your approach further and further and further. So it is not, and even if it is a physical teacher, a realized master, whom you have, here it is saying that you go and Gurum Shantam, a guru who is shant, who is established, who is in silence, in his established in himself, shantam, upa asit madatmakam, and go and sit near him. It is not ask, go and ask questions and make his life a hell. Go and sit near him. You don't need to tell the light, hey, give me light. You have to just sit under the light. Light automatically takes away the darkness, isn't it? You don't have to go and say to the heat, please remove the cold that I am feeling right now. You go and sit near the fire, cold automatically goes away and you become warm. Exactly the same way. You go and sit near the teacher who is established in the self without asking any questions, automatically all cobwebs get cleared. But, point of caution, here, if you go to a realized master thinking that he is the body, then you will lose the plot. You have to approach the master that he is established in the truth. What is that foundation in which he is established? What is that because of which he has got this unifying vision? What is that because of which he sees no differences, even though he's functioning through this body? And they say that the one who's functioning through him is also functioning through me. Our attention should not be, we should not be form oriented. Then we'll be only wanting to touch the feet and wipe our dirty hands on his feet or her feet. We are, our attention is on what is the foundation on which this realized master is standing. You must have heard before that I've been saying, when I travel with Swamiji, I see from what space does he function out of. He's the same person who comes every year. But what is that space? That nothing ruffles him. Always the same pace, always the same smile. I want to catch that space. I don't want to catch the person. I want to catch the space. You don't want to catch the bulb. You want to catch the light. You want to get the light. Isn't it? You don't want to catch the body. You all know this body is going to die. That's why you come to a satsang, because you want to catch the spirit or you or the Lord himself. So be focused on it. Don't shortchange yourself by becoming form oriented and start thinking that this form is divine, Satya Sai Baba form is divine, Ammachi form is divine. Form can never be divine. It is the principle which is expressing through, and that principle and the principle which is expressing through you as life is one and the same. That one has purified themselves, therefore their vision has changed. You have not purified, that's why you are at awe in their presence. See? So here when they say, find a guru who is established in the self and sit near it. Where sit near? Sit within yourself, my friends. Why you want to look for a form outside? This is also a form, and the guru is within this form, expressing as life. Sit near it. How? By bringing your attention to it. What is that which is missing in a dead person but is available in this living body? Come to that point. Again and again, keep striking, 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 striking. One day by grace it will click. Just like you keep striking the sleep, but you can't, you are not there to realize which striking absorbed you into sleep. Keep striking, keep striking, keep striking on that Sadguru within, on that principle within. Then in the, where were we? Sixth verse. Hey, kya time kya ho gaya? Oh, because in the between phone call came, no? That I'm thinking, how only 1:22? Jyada ho gaya time. We'll conclude. Now I realize when he got up. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harihi Om. Someone should remember.